Gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 through 46. Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me.' Then they will answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?' Then he will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Bluetooth. Bluetooth technology. That's where we take two technologies and we unify them into one. So for instance, you can take electronics and then the internet. And so we are combining these two and making them one. Bluetooth technology. But you may wonder, why is it called Bluetooth? Well, it's named after an 11th century Viking king by the name of Harald Bluetooth Grossum. And so he was a great king, but he had a decayed tooth, and apparently it was kind of bluish in color. And so he got the nickname Bluetooth. And so we're thinking, well, how does this modern technology now be named after some Viking king's rotten tooth? Well, I'll expand it further. Like I said, he was a great king. He was the king of Denmark. He became a Christian, and he's the one who was instrumental in converting Denmark to Christianity. He was a very strong a military leader. He was a good administrator. He put the people first. And so people are doing well. People are doing well in the land. Well, when Norway needed a king, and with a monarchy, monarchies are good as long as you have a good king. As the king goes, so goes the nation. So if you have a good king, then everybody's going to be happy. If you got a bad king, well, then I'll tell you what, there's going to be lots of problems in society. And so Norway, I don't know if they just were looking, well, do we have any candidates here? And they want to live well, and they're looking over to Denmark, look at how they're living. And so what do? They go to King Harald Bluetooth, and they ask him, are you willing to be our king? Could you be our king? And so King Harald Bluetooth became also the king of Norway. And so now Norway is doing well. But that's the idea. You got one king serving and unifying two nations. And everything went well for both countries until his son, Sven Forkbeard, he went about a coup, and as a result, King Harald Bluetooth was killed. But today, that's where we get that. That's what Bluetooth is named. Matter of fact, even the icon, that's a Viking runic letters, his symbol. And that would be the symbol for it. And so when we think about today being Christ the King Sunday, Jesus has come as the King. He has left his throne, and he has come into this world. And his goal is to be, in a sense, a spiritual Bluetooth, to unite all the nations of the world together, to unite all people together. And so that we all may know Jesus. That we all may know Jesus as Savior. And so when we study Paul's letter to the church of Ephesus, the book of Ephesians, that's what it so much is about, is that God in Jesus is uniting all things, uniting heaven and earth together, uniting the angels and the animals, uniting nations. And that's God's will and desire, is to bring salvation and to unite all people in him. Now, throughout my life, I've heard a lot of people say, and matter of fact, even today, there are people who are very adamant to say that the United States is a Christian nation. In fact, if you go to other nations in the world and ask what religion is the United States, they will say Christian. But then I talk to other people that say, well, I just don't see it. Could you show me anything that would make us believe that the United States is Christian? Well, here again, I don't want to get into this argument today, because people feel very passionate about it, one way or the other. But one thing I can say is this, is that the kingdom of Christ has been established in this country. And how is it established? That Jesus establishes his kingdom in the hearts of the believers, coming together to be the church. That the church has been established in the United States. But with that said, it's also been established in Canada. It's been established in Mexico. It's been established, well, believe it or not, in Iran and Iraq. It might be very small, and it might be underground, but it's there. In fact, I knew a guy who was actually a missionary to Iraq. It's been established in Russia, in all the nations of the world. And that is what's so powerful about it, is that the kingdom of Christ extends all supersedes all boundaries. And that's the hope, is that you've got people that have the love of God within them and that are striving and working for peace and for unity for all. That's the desire of God and for all the nations, that we live in peace and harmony, that all people may prosper we certainly can see that when nations are not doing this, just the pain and the destruction of lives and the cost, and it's just, you don't want war. But when we look at Ephesians, you know, the Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19, that he says that basically, well, he's a Roman citizen, but he's a citizen of heaven. So he's got kind of like this dual citizenship, that he's not of this world, but yet he's in this world working and proclaiming and spreading the good news of Jesus as far as he could go. We think about what is written, what John wrote in Revelation chapter 11, verse 15, that the kingdom of this world is the kingdom now of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. That the gospel goes forth bringing freedom to us. And even though we're in bondage to sin, that we cannot free ourselves, but it is the truth of Jesus Christ that sets us free. And so, and we read at the end of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 20, where the Apostle Paul says that I am an ambassador in chains. And so we have to realize that when Paul is writing so many of his letters, that he is writing them from prison. So even though, yes, physically he was bound in chains, but yet he always saw himself as free. That even in his chains, that he was ministering to others in the world. And so that brings me to the gospel lesson today. That Jesus is the King, and on that final day, he will bring judgment upon the people. He will separate the sheep from the goats. Now, it's just happened a few times throughout my ministry where I've had people that come to me and just say, now, you remember, Pastor Jeff, that Jesus is the judge. And of course, the whole implication here is that, I think they think that I'm a very judgmental person, and I'm basically judging everybody to hell. And just remember that Jesus is the judge. In other words, there's some good news there. Well, that is good news, that Jesus is the judge. But when I start thinking about it, if I were the judge on the final day, guess what? Everybody will be saved. You're all in. But yet, I'm not the judge. And that's what we have to remember, that you remember, Pastor, and I'll say, let's all remember that Jesus is the judge. And so what is judgment in relationship to a holy God? And so we better take Jesus seriously. But yet he's the one who's laid down his life for us. And that salvation has come to us as a result of him. And so Jesus, as we look at his judgment, as far as how will this go. And we get different glimpses of it here and there, but we get one of those today. Where what we learn is that when we study the Gospel of John, where Jesus says that the Father and I are one, but then those whom I send will be one with me and thus one with the Father. So in other words, the ambassadors, whether they're in chains or not, that they're going out. And as they speak the word of Christ, that they are representing Jesus. So Jesus says that they represent me. And so as they go out, when you think about the early church, as they're sent out, they're basically sent out with nothing. They have no place to stay. Oftentimes they would be sleeping under the stars. They wouldn't have much to eat. As a result of being out there, they were sick a lot. Many Christians who were proclaiming the word were sent to prison. And so that's all what Jesus is saying, is that when I send my people out, that I expect the rest of the church to support them. Yeah, support them in your prayer and finances, resources. Sometimes we're doing work together. But Jesus is saying that to the one who is supporting, the missionary, the proclaimer, And when you welcome them into your homes, when you visit them in prison, in the hospital, when you give them food and clothing, and you provide for them, you are providing for me. Jesus says, as much as you've done it to one of the least of these, my people, you've done it unto me. In other words, you're part of the church, that we're in this together. But for those who, I'm not going to support this, I'm not going to be part of the program, so to speak, well, then Jesus says, understand that this is how you will be judged. And then, of course, we also look at this whole text as Christians in relationship to the general caring of people. That we're concerned about the homeless and the hungry, those who need medical care. We're concerned about those who are in prison. Whatever the needs may be, that as Christian people, that when we think about a loving, gracious God who has died on a cross for us, that he expects his people to be compassionate, to be loving and merciful as well. Now, here again, every day I go down and I feed my feral cats down at Sucks Lake. But the last few days, as I've been down there in the parking lot, I've noticed that there's somebody living in his car. And part of why I find that there's oftentimes a car there is because there's a public restroom right there in that building. But it's been cold nights out there. I can't imagine sleeping in a car and living in a car night after night after night. And so as I walk by with my bag of cat food, then I have to look at that car and think, now what can I be doing? Maybe I can go out and buy some gas carts, food carts, at restaurants or something. But you know, I don't think it takes rocket science here to figure something out, to be able to help a lot of these people who are in desperate situations and need. And so I walk by. Jeff, when did you see me homeless in a car? Are you just going to walk by with your cat food? Or are you going to do something about it? I mean, that's what Jesus is getting at here. Look at out here. We got all these different things, trees and baskets and boxes, looking to be filled with food and toys and whatever it is. And I know you as a church, you're so generous to be filling those up. And we got a lot of them now to fill up, and lots of trees with tags on them. We do it to one of the least of these. We do it to Jesus. We do it for Jesus. So on this Christ the King Sunday, let us realize and recognize all of what the King has done for us. This day that we declare, Jesus, you are King, and we ask you, be my King this day. Amen.